died with Christ and rose with him to new life, may he now share with him eternal glory. Let us pray. O God, Almighty Father, our faith professes that your Son died and rose again. Mercifully grant that through this mystery, your servant who has fallen asleep in Christ may rejoice to rise again through him, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God, forever and ever.
Amen.
Please be seated. A reading from the Book of Wisdom. The just man, though he die early, shall be at rest. For the age that is honorable comes not with the passing of time, nor can it be measured in terms of years. Rather, understanding is the hoary crown for men, and an unsullied life the attainment of old age. He who pleased God was loved. He who lived among sinners was transported, snatched away lest wickedness pervert his mind or deceit beguile his soul. For the witchery of paltry things obscures what is right, and the whirl of desire transforms the innocent mind. Having become perfect in a short while, he reached the fullness of a long career, for his soul was pleasing to the Lord. Therefore he sped him out of the midst of wickedness. But the people saw and did not understand, nor did they take this into account. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Romans. Brothers and sisters, hope does not disappoint, because the love of God has been poured out into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us. For Christ, while we were still helpless, died at the appointed time for the ungodly. Indeed, only with difficulty does one die for a just person, though perhaps for a good person one might even find courage to die. But God proves his love for us in that, while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. How much more then, since we are now justified by his blood, will we be saved through him from the wrath? Indeed, if while we were enemies, we were reconciled to God through the death of his Son, how much more, once reconciled, will we be saved by his life? Not only that, but we also boast of God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have now received reconciliation. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Saying, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are they who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the land. Blessed are they who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be satisfied. Blessed are the merciful, for they will be shown mercy. Blessed are the clean of heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God. Blessed are they who are persecuted for the sake of righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. And blessed are you when they insult you, and persecute you, and utter every kind of evil against you falsely because of me. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward will be great in heaven." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise
Jesus. Please be seated. Most people, I think, especially those who are religious, who read the Bible, but I think in the Western world anyway, even a lot of people who are not religious and who are not familiar with the New Testament all that much, are maybe somewhat familiar with this reading from Matthew's Gospel today, the Beatitudes, we call. And it's interesting to imagine, I think, because we're all so used to it, because we've heard it so many times, maybe when we hear it, we don't really think about it that much, except for that it seems to be just some very nice words from the Bible, some comforting words from the Bible, which of course it is. But it's interesting, I think, to go back and imagine we were hearing it for the first time. Imagine we were hearing Jesus say those words for the very first time. We were there, up on the mountain, as it said, listening. If we heard it for the first time, what we would have heard was something very strange. Because in that time, as in our own time, very often, the way we look at life or blessings from God, right, are whether or not we are receiving materially what we want, right? Whether we have enough money, whether we have health, whether we have kind of comfort and ease and all of those things, right? And if we have them, that's a blessing from God. And if it's one of those things, or more than one of those things, are taken away from me, then I must have been kind of abandoned by God. Right? I must have been done something to have God punish me, right? But what Jesus is saying is very strange. He says, "Blessed are the poor." He used to be, "Blessed are the rich." "Blessed are they who mourn." Doesn't feel like a blessing. Blessed are the meek, usually in terms of material prosperity, blessed are the forceful, right? Not the meek. Blessed are the merciful, very often the vengeful, those who hold grudges, those who kind of exact revenge on other people. They seem to be getting the upper hand most of the time, right? Blessed are you when you're persecuted. Blessed are those who are persecuted for the sake of righteousness, right? It's the entrance into Christianity of the seeming contradiction. The statements of Jesus that, at first glance, when we really look at them for the first time, they don't seem to make much sense. But they get much bigger than that. They get much greater than that. Those who save their lives will lose it. Those who believe in me, even if they die, will not die. How can somebody who dies not die? It's prefigured, right, in the Book of Wisdom, where it says of the dead that they seem in the view of the foolish to be dead, but in reality they are alive. Jesus says elsewhere too that to God all are alive. What does that mean? It means that we don't always see things clearly, you and I. Even when we try, even when we know things, we don't really see things always as they are. That's what it means, that phrase, in the view of the foolish, they seem to be dead. That's what Jesus is getting at in the Sermon on the Mount, right? When he's saying all of these things that seem to be punishments, that seem to be curses, are actually blessings. Because we just see the here and the now. We just see what's in front of us. The people whom we love, the people who we cared about who died, they seem dead, and that's it. Then it's done. When we lose our health, or when somebody that we love loses their health, or their well-being, or their financial security, or anything else, right? When there's this, when tragedies hit, when bad things happen, it looks to us like a bad thing. And only a bad thing. Very often. What Jesus wants us to understand is that there's something beyond just this, right? There's something beyond just this life. There's something beyond just this world. The true blessing is not the blessing in this life. It's good to have good things in this life. It's good to have money. It's good to have our health. It's good to have all of these things that we want, that we seek after in the world. But the idea is that all of those things, even if we have them, are going to go away. Can be the richest person in the world, right? And there's going to come a time when that money's not going to do you much good. Right? You can be in the best health in the world, but that health isn't going to last forever. This body eventually runs out. This body eventually dies. And what Jesus is telling us and what he's reminding us of is to look for that which lasts forever. The true blessing of God. Is the one that doesn't have an expiration date on it. It's the one that doesn't kind of go away. Financial security is good. Health is good. All those things are good. But they don't last forever. The blessing from God lasts forever. It's a reminder to us, especially when we experience the death of someone that we know, someone that we love, someone that we care about. Because it's very often the case that we experience their death, right? But we also remember our own mortality. It's kind of hard to forget that. That what we're talking about in our faith, what Jesus is talking about, what we believe in Christianity, isn't some abstract eternal life. It's not that this person, or that me, or that you, will live on just in the memories of other people, right? Because that has an expiration date on it, too. There are billions of people who have lived before us that are not really that well remembered by the world today. But what we're talking about is a real and true blessing that lasts forever. Eternal life, real, eternal life, actual, eternal life. Not a metaphor, not a symbol, not something that means something else, not something that just kind of, like I said, comforts us with soothing words, but real and actual, everlasting life. This is what Christianity promises. This is what baptism promises. This is what our faith promises. And this is what we believe. And this is why we're here today in this chapter. pray for one of our number who has gone before us. As we say, gone before us, marked with the sign of faith. To pray that he will experience quickly, in short order, that eternal life, that real and everlasting life, that true and lasting blessing from God, lasting longer than any blessing that he might have received in this life, and lasting longer than any suffering he might have experienced in this life, or pain, or difficulty, lasting forever. We pray to God for him, we pray to God for ourselves too, that in our sorrow, in our mourning, that we may be comforted, and that we may be assured of our pledge of everlasting life too, and that we may seek that as well. So we come to pray for our brethren, we come to honor our God, and we come in that hope of life everlasting. Our presence here is a testimony to that hope. Our presence here is a testimony, hopefully, to that belief. And as we go forth from this place, confident in the pledge of Almighty God and the promise that he made to our brother and to us, that we'll find our way back home to God from this life, that we'll seek those blessings that last forever, and we'll be reunited with our brother and all of our brothers and sisters in the eternal kingdom of God in that true and everlasting life. Let us in faith call upon God, the Almighty Father, who raised Christ, his Son, from the dead, as we pray for the salvation of the living and the dead. That God may establish the Christian people in faith and unity, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That he may rescue the entire world from all the evils of war, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That he may be pleased to show himself a father to our brothers and sisters who lack work, food, or housing, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That he may be pleased to admit forever into the company of saints his deceased servant, our brother, who once through baptism received the seed of eternal life, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That on the last day he may raise up our brother, who fed on the body of Christ, the bread of eternal life, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That he may graciously help and comfort our brothers and sisters who are suffering affliction, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That he may be pleased to gather into his glorious kingdom all who have gathered here in faith and devotion, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
May the prayer of those who cry to you benefit the souls of your servants, O Lord. Free them, we pray, from all their sins, and make them sharers in your redemption through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
Easy seated.
Thank you.
Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good of all his holy church.
As we humbly present to you these sacrificial offerings, O Lord, for the salvation of your servant, we beseech your mercy that he who did not doubt your Son to be a loving Savior may find in him a merciful judge who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. In him the hope of blessed resurrection has dawned, that those saddened by the certainty of dying might be consoled by the promise of immortality to come. Indeed, for your faithful Lord, life is changed, not ended. And when this earthly dwelling turns to dust, an eternal dwelling is made ready for them in heaven. And so with angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, and with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory as without end we acclaim. Your sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice. And giving you thanks, he said the blessing and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory. The mystery of faith. And as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray, upon the oblation of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim by whose death you willed to reconcile us to yourself. Grant that we who are nourished with the body and blood of your Son and filled with his Holy Spirit, may become one body and one spirit in Christ. May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, and with all the saints, on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth, with your servant Francis, our Pope, and Peter, our Bishop, the order of bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. Remember your servant Stan, whom you have called from this world to yourself. Grant that he who is united with your Son in a death like his may also be one with him in his resurrection. And from the earth he will raise up in the flesh those who have died, and transform our lowly body after the pattern of his own glorious body. To our departed brothers and sisters, too, and to all who are pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory, when you will wipe away every tear from our eyes. For seeing you, our God, as you are, we shall be like you for all the ages, and praise you without end, through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Through him and with him and in him, O God, almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever. By the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, peace I leave you, my peace I give you, look not on our sins but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I am worthy that you should enter under my roof, but
all the
saints of
our
world
and my soul shall be healed.
Thank you. time, I'd like to invite anyone who is a practicing Catholic and is properly disposed to come forward and receive communion at this time. If you are not practicing Catholic or if you're not properly disposed at the time, you're free to stay in your pew and pray. Lord God, whose Son left us in the sacrament of his body food for the journey, mercifully grant that strengthened by it our brother may come to the eternal table of Christ, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen. Amen.
Before we go our separate ways, let us take leave of our brother. May our farewell express our affection for him, may it ease our sadness and strengthen our hope. One day we shall joyfully greet him when the love of Christ, which conquers all things, destroys even death itself.
Thank you.
of mercies, we commend our brother in the sure and certain hope that together with all who have died in Christ, he will rise with him on the last day. We give you thanks for the blessings which you have bestowed upon him in this life. They are signs to us of your goodness and of our fellowship with the saints in Christ. Merciful Lord, turn toward us and listen to our prayers. Open the gates of paradise to your servant and help us who remain to comfort one another with assurances of faith. Until we all meet in Christ and are with you and with our brother forever, we ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
In peace, let us take our brother to his place of rest.
Sharon Memorial Park. If you need the address, we can get it to you as you want.